بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا إنه من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا اللهم اشرح لنا صدورنا ويسر لنا أمورنا واحلل عقد ألسنتنا نفقه قول بعضنا. Dear brothers and sisters, Abu Jahl, the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his name between his people was not Abu Jahl. His name that now we know him by Abu Jahl, he gained that name. He acquired that name because the Muslims called him Abu Jahl due to his attitude. Before he gained that name, he had a name that the meaning of it is 180 degree, the opposite of Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl means the father of ignorance. His name was Abu al-Hakam, the father of wisdom. And that name was given to him by his people because he was wise in making decisions that benefited the society of Mecca. So throughout his life before Islam, he was known to be the one that is able to lead the tribe, his tribe, and lead Mecca in the right direction in order to achieve things that can help them in their financial systems, in their social systems, in their justice system. However, when Islam came, he had two characteristics. These two characteristics prevented him from being able to accept Islam and being able to embrace this roadmap, which is the Quran that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. And these two characteristics are actually described in Surat Al-Alaq in the second phase, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Kalla innal insana la yatgha ar-ra'ahu istaghna." إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجَعَىٰ. And what that means is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a physical manifestation of the characteristic that Abu Jahl had, which is that he has طغيان. And the word طغى here is translated usually in the translations of the Quran as transgressed. However, the word طغى goes far beyond transgression. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses it in describing the water, when the water went up so high during the time of Nuh alayhi salam that it covered the earth. So the word tagha is to go excessively beyond the limits, so much so that the limits themselves are not considered limits for that individual. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing the Quran and he's saying, "Kalla innal insana la yatgha," indeed, or no, but indeed, the human being will do the stughyan. Will go excessively beyond the limit. And when we say go excessively beyond the limit, that specifically linguistically here, what it means is that they purposely choose to do so. Some people cross the limits because they're ignorant, but the word طغيان means to cross the limits when you know the truth. So that's the first characteristic that Abu Jahl had, is that he had this attribute of طغيان. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes why that happened. And he says, أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Abu Jahl and any person that goes to that level of طغيان has a heart disease. And that heart disease is the illusion of self-sufficiency. The word استغنى comes from غنى, and غنى means to be self-sufficient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is known to be الغني, the self-sufficient. But when you put it in the form that is istaghna, linguistically, it means that person is under the illusion that they are self-sufficient. So what leads the human being to not accept the message is excessively crossing the limits, not seeing the limit, and the root cause is a heart disease, that them feeling in and within themselves that they're self-sufficient, they don't need anybody. And let me give you an example from modern time. I'm sure you guys have seen on YouTube those videos where a group of friends, they prank one of their buddies. And what they do is that they get a lottery ticket and they write on it the winning lottery number. And then they start videotaping the person, and then they tell that person, "Look, you have won the lottery ticket." And those videos usually go viral because of the reaction of that individual. That person, when he knows or if he thinks that he won the lottery ticket, he'll flip 180 degrees. He will go and attack his spouse. Well, he will attack his wife, he will dump his wife, he'll start attacking his parents, tell them, you know, you are the worst, you know, you've kept me held here, you're preventing me from succeeding. He will go to his friends and will tell them, I don't need you, I'm just sticking around with you because I need to stick around with you. Now I have all that money, I don't need any of you guys, I'm gonna just walk out and build a life for myself. And it's actually very comical because that attitude was kept in and within himself because he felt he needed them and he needed other people around him. The moment he had that illusion that he doesn't need them because he gained that money, he flipped 180 degrees. And the comical side is that after he realizes that this is a joke, it takes him a while to come back. Some of them refuse to accept it. They've gone way too far, they've lost all their friends, they've dumped their spouses, and now they know that it is a joke. And those two characteristics manifest because that person was under the illusion that he was self-sufficient. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in the Quran those two characteristics. And those were in Abu Jahl. And the question is right now, because the Quran showed the physical manifestation of that heart disease and then talked about the root problem, which is the heart disease, what is the solution? The solution comes in the third ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna ila rabbika ar-ruj'a." Indeed, to your master is the return. And just to bring this into perspective, I'll give you an example of two incidences, one that happened in 1920 and one that happened 1400 years ago during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the States in 1920, there was the 18th Amendment to the Constitution, which basically prohibited alcohol. It happened in 1920 for the 18th Amendment that was voted on by majority of the government because it was demanded by society that alcohol is to be forbidden. And this didn't just happen overnight. There was a lot of work that was being done by the Protestants, specifically the Pietism movement in the Protestants of the Christian denomination over the years. When that was voted in, although society accepted it as a whole, from 1920 until 1933, when that amendment was ratified, the rebellion that happened in the US society is unprecedented. So during those 13 years, the amount of alcohol that was illegally brewed and the amount of alcohol that was consumed and sold, despite all the armies and all the security and all the police force, was unprecedented. Because people at that time felt like, you know, you're not the boss of me now. I'm gonna do that and I'm not gonna obey the law. And it went so bad that many people even got sick, because when you start brewing alcohol in your home and you're not following certain health considerations, you're just going to get sick and you're going to die. And in 1933, after all the disasters that happened due to that amendment, and for the first time in history, in the US history, they had to come up with another amendment that ratified that first amendment. In the whole US history, no amendment to the Constitution was ratified through another amendment except for this one. And that's because people's drives were not based on that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A similar thing happened during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the commands that إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوا. That alcohol, as well as other acts of and other sins, are the work of the devil, so leave it alone. And people instantly at that time, if you had a cup in your hand, because the Sahaba were drinking at that time, it wasn't forbidden, they poured it out. They didn't go and hide it. And then many of them had jugs, like big jugs of alcohol. They didn't worry about how much that costed or how much the amount was. They poured it down in the streets of Medina. And some of them who drank and then they heard that message, they gagged themselves out in order to take that alcohol out of them. And that was not an issue, that was a complete embrace for that alcohol is forbidden. And the reason for that is that the connection and the drive was because they knew Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they had that drive that stemmed from the fact that Inna ila rabbika ar-ruj'a. Indeed, to your master is the return. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فيا فوز المستغفرين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. Dear brothers and sisters, this is the last section of Surat Al-Alaq. And in the last section, the last 11 ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an example from the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for someone who did not understand how to embrace this message correctly. And that person was Abu Jahl, the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And although he was known as Abu al-Hakam, the father of wisdom, the Muslims gave him the title of Abu Jahl, the father of ignorance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, during the next 11 ayat, which we will not dive too deep into it, gives the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a situation, a hypothetical situation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do you see if that person was actually righteous? And do you see him if he commands, you know, good? Do you see him if he was on guidance? Do you see him if he was not, or do you see him if he, how he would be if he was not constantly denying this message and campaigning against it? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this, he is showing that just like the Prophet Muhammad saw that there are good characteristics that were in Abu Jahl. And that's why the Prophet Muhammad said, Allahumma izz al-Islam bi ahad al-umarain. Oh Allah, give victory and izzah to Islam with one of the two umars. Bi ahab al-umarain ilayk. With the umar that is more beloved to you. Either Umar al-Khattab or this Abu Jahl, because his name was also Umar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided Umar al-Khattab. But here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving that hypothetical situation to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying, imagine if this person that is known to be the father of wisdom, was actually on guidance. How different would he be? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that this person will not accept Islam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finishes the ayat with a threat. And that threat stemmed from a story, actually multiple stories, in which Abu Jahl, when he saw the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praying at the Kaaba, he went and he threatened to step on his neck. And in another place, he threatened to take a rock and smash the Prophet Muhammad's head. And in another instance, which actually happened, he went and he brought the garbage that come out of a slaughtered camel, the skin of the camel, as well as all the inner parts of it, and he dumped it on top of the Prophet Muhammad, and it was so heavy that the Prophet Muhammad couldn't get up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this Abu Jahl did all these things, and specifically after the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ came from At-Ta'if, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it upon himself to protect Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Abu Jahl, every time he approached the Prophet, he would see a ditch of fire and a group of creatures that are ready to grab him if he steps any closer. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a story that one time Abu Jahl walked up to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he told him, didn't I tell you to stop praying? And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him in a firm way, you know, leave me alone. So he said, you know that if I call upon the people of Mecca, I am one of the people that will be able to gather the most number of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here in the Quran, he mentions this, and he says that, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, he says that, كَلَّا لَإِنْ لَمْ يَنْتَهِ لَنَسْفَعًا بِالنَّاصِيَةِ نَاصِيَةٍ كَاذِبَةٍ خَاطِئَةٍ. That if he doesn't stop from doing what he's doing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will drag him from his forehead. So this is a connotation that when you're being dragged from your head, your forehead, you've lost all hope. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَهُ. Let him call all his people. سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةِ. We'll call the special army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the army of angels that are meant to protect and guard hell. This is the army, the angels of punishment. And when Abu Jahl heard that, he knew the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is truthful. He never stepped. He never called anybody because he knew if he did, something bad will happen. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends the ayah or the surah with the message that is the essence of this whole Quran and for this whole surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَلَّا لَا تُطِعْهُ وَاسْجُدْ وَاقْتَرِبْ. Don't obey him and don't bother about him. Linguistically, لا تُطِعْهُ If you transliterate it, it means don't obey him. But if you actually look at the linguistic meaning, it means that don't even bother with him. He's a nobody. Wasjud, continue prostrating. Waqtarib, and come near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is a connection between this, the ibadah, and between the beginning of the ayah. The themes in the Qur'an mainly focuses on three themes. The first theme is al-aql al-dhaki, the intelligent mind. And the second theme is al-qalb al-naqi, the pure heart. And the third theme is al-yawm al-akhir, the last day. And in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions all three of them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started this surah with iqra, which is talking to the mind. You read and you learn. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the diseases of the heart. كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرَّآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finishes with إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى, which is the remembrance that there is a return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a day of judgment. And that we have to remember that once we put things in perspective, putting things in perspective requires an intellectual approach. Then we can purify our heart and reach that sound heart that we're trying to get to. Hence, when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we'll be near Him. And hence, every sajda that we do from now until we die, in theory, it should get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it doesn't get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're missing the point. We're missing the point. It's not in how many sajdas you do. It is in the quality of the sajdas that you do. هذا وصلى وسلم على من أمركم الله سبحانه وتعالى بالصلاة والسلام عليه فقال جل من قائل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم ارض عن الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن الصحابة أجمعين وعن التابعين ومن تبعهم بإيمان وإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وأدخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد.